We are in week two of a Christmas series we're calling Carols of Christmas. And this week I was reading about a short story writer named Bret Hart, not the wrestler, but another Bret Hart with the last name H-A-R-T-E. He lived in the 1800s, and he was a short story fiction writer who wrote often about gambling and the romantic figures of the California gold rush and about miners, those who were mining for gold those days. And he particularly had a story called The Luck of Roaring Camp. The Luck of Roaring Camp. And he wrote the story about a small mining town called Roaring Camp. Now, in this town were 100 men. And these were the roughest, toughest, meanest guys you can imagine. They were all miners, but some of them were criminals. Others were fugitives, but everybody was reckless. It was literally the most unsafe community you could live in. No families lived there because this was a highly crime-invested city. Well, there was one lady who lived in Roaring Camp. Her name was Cherokee Sal. And one day, she gave birth to a baby. Well, these rough, tough men, harsh, unforgiving men, they were used to death, but they were not used to a birth. Like, they had no idea what to do with a baby. So they began to think, what do we do with this child, this infant? Do we give them away? Do we send them to another community? And after much deliberation, they decided to keep and raise this little boy. They named him Thomas Luck. And here's the cover of this short story. It's this group of men trying to figure out what to do with this baby, like most dads probably do. But here they are. What do we do with this child? So named him Thomas Luck. And so they just placed this child in a box that had some old rags in it, and they said, okay, we'll just let this baby sleep here. And they said, this just doesn't look right. We need to get him a cradle. And so one of the guys went 80 miles out and bought a rosewood cradle to put the baby in, brought it back, and so there they are with this cradle, stole the rags in it, and placed the baby inside of it. They said, no. We got to remove the rags. Somebody go out to Sacramento and go buy some clean silk blankets. And they did. They went out and got some new blankets, brought the blankets back, and now cover the baby in blankets and put him in this rosewood cradle. And now the floors looked filthy. We got to clean the floors. And these tough men got on their hands and knees, began to scrub until the floors were spotless finally. Now they looked around. Man, these walls and these ceilings are really, really filthy, and there are no curtains. So these men begin to repaint the walls and the ceiling. They put some curtains down, and they realize this baby loves to sleep. And they're like, we can't be fighting and arguing while the baby's asleep. So while the baby sleeps, we're going to hit pause on all the arguments and all the fighting. And for the first time in Roaring Camp, there was a lot of silence and quietness and calm. And the baby would wake up from the nap, and they would take little Tommy outside on the village, on the community steps, and they realized there is not a single flower or garden for the child to stare at. Let's go plant some flowers. And they did. They planted the first garden ever in Roaring Camp. They came back and realized how dirty their hands were and how clean the baby's hands were. They said, we should probably start taking showers around here. So they went to the local Dollar General and bought out all their soap and shampoo and shaving gear. And for the first time, these miners, these men began to take showers, thank goodness, right? And they even came back and they said, you know what? We don't want little Tommy to grow up all by himself with no kids to play with. Let's build a community center so the families from the region will move in and our little Tommy would have friends. The story, The Luck of Roaring Camp, is about Thomas Luck and how the birth of this child, this innocent baby, changed a community of delinquent men and transformed. Why? Because the baby changed everything. Well, this Christmas season, we are celebrating the fact that the world has been changed by the birth of a Savior. Amen. Not just because he was a cute 8 pounds, 6 ounces sweet baby Jesus, according to Ricky Bobby. No. But because he was God in the flesh, Emmanuel, Almighty God, took on flesh and came to us. And here's the reality. He not just changed a few people or one community, he has changed the world. Meaning, because he came in the flesh and now lives through his spirit, he changes you. Changes me. He reorients our whole life. He convicts us and he cleanses us, challenges us and comforts us. He erases our past and gives new meaning and purpose to life. He saves us and he sends us. Most likely you are here because the coming of Jesus changed your story. It rewrote your life. And you can be a lot of things about Jesus, but one thing you cannot be is be indifferent about who he is and the claims he made about himself. This child changed the world. And we're peeking into this Christmas story, the birth of this Savior, by looking at well-known carols or hymns, these songs that are written right out of the scripture that tell us the amazing story of who Jesus is. And last weekend, we began with O Come, Emmanuel, which taught us that it's possible that this season you can have both joy and longing. And that's a reality for many of us this Christmas season. But today, I want us to look at this hymn, Hark, the Herald, Angels Sing. Hark the Herald, Angels Sing. This hymn was written by Charles Wesley in 1739. Charles Wesley, along with John Wesley, started the Methodist movement, now which is a denomination. And Charles Wesley, if you didn't know, he wrote over 6,500 hymns, a prolific author, over 6,500 hymns. And this particular hymn, he wrote just a year after he came to Christ. So as he's reflecting back on his newfound faith, he began to think about the wonder of God coming to earth, and he began to write this hymn. Though he had published it, it took it several years for it to actually be well known until it got into the hands of another preacher by the name of George Whitefield, who came alongside and began to tweak some of the lines and change the title of this hymn to Hark the Herald, Angels Sing. And then it just became an incredible anthem for the Church of Jesus during this season. I want you to read with me the first lines of this hymn, and it goes like this. Hark, the herald, angels sing. I said read with me, so let's try it again. Hark, the herald, angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. I imagine that none of you this week used this word, hark. No, not one, all right? It's an old English term which simply means listen up, pay attention. Something amazing is about to be told, so listen up. And I would actually challenge you this week, look for opportunities to use this word, hark. Like just look for random opportunities. Use it with your kids. Hark, children, dinner is ready. Use it with a coworker you don't like all that much, okay? Susie, hark, let's go to lunch. Just see what they do. Use it with your spouse. Say it in the most beautiful, romantic way. Hark, honey, I gotta tell you, you mean so much to me. I love you. Use it with a stranger and see how quickly they run away from you. Hark, what? Hark, the herald, angels sing. Notice there's an exclamation mark at the end of hark, because it is an imperative invitation for us to come together and listen to the announcement that's about to be made. Hark the herald. Herald means an official messenger, someone who is delivering really important official news. And who is the herald? The angels. Hark the herald. The angels sing. And the response to the news that they are bringing is glory to the newborn King. The response is worship. It is singing about this newborn King. Well, if you're somewhat familiar with the Christmas story, you'll realize, okay, this is a moment where the angels came to the shepherds with a really amazing message and announcement about the newborn King. And yes, you're right. It is bringing us back to Luke 2 and the scene of the angel and the shepherds. And here's how Luke 2 records it. And even if you've read this many times, I want you to hear it afresh and see the power and the wonder of this moment where the greatest announcement was made. Luke records it like this in verse 8 of Luke 2. In the same region, shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified, and so would I. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped tightly in cloth and lying in a manger. Suddenly, all of a sudden, there was a multitude of the heavenly hosts. One angel brought the message, and immediately thousands of angels gathered around with the angel. What did they do? Praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors. Glory to God and peace on earth. The heart of this passage and the heart of this hymn is twofold. This hymn, this passage, invites us, first of all, into the wonder of who this message is about. And second of all, it invites us into the wonder of who this message is for. Who is this? Who is this message, this announcement about? And second of all, who is it given to? Who is it for? So let's answer the question of who is this message about? Who is this announcement about? Help me out. Jesus. When you're asked a question, if you're doubting, just say Jesus. He's usually the answer. Not all the time, but most of the time, he is the answer. This message is about the announcement of a king who has been born to us. It's about the coming of Jesus. But what I love about this passage and the uniqueness of this message is that it's the angels bringing this announcement. And the angels, hear me, the angels have an absolutely unique perspective on Jesus, the Son of God, that no one else in the Christmas narrative had. Like all of the other individuals in the narrative, like Mary and Joseph, or Zacharias and Elizabeth, or Simeon and Anna, the shepherds, the wise men, they're all meeting the Son of God for the first time. And they're meeting him in the flesh. Their first visual experience with the Son of God is as a baby in human form, as a child, as a helpless infant. That's their first impression. But the angels have a totally different vantage point. Why? Because for thousands and thousands of years, they have seen Jesus as the Son of God before he became the Son of Man. They have been spending years and eons worshiping him, honoring him. He has been the object of their worship. They saw him as powerful, mighty, and glorious before we meet him in the manger as meek and mild. Oh, they have a perspective on Jesus because they've seen him in an eternity past. Job 38 says that when God established the earth, the angels shouted for joy. The angels shouted for joy when Jesus made the world. They were there. These same angels we meet in Luke 2 with this announcement, they were there when Jesus created all things, visible and invisible. They shouted for joy. They were there in the garden when Adam and Eve ate of the forbidden fruit and sin entered the story. And they were also right there when God made the promise that the offspring of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. And for thousands of years, they have been wondering, how is God going to do this? How is he going to overcome sin and death and the grave? How is he going to reconcile humanity back to himself? When is he going to do it? I imagine every generation they wondered, is it now? Is it here? Is it with this people? Is it with that people? They have been longing to see the fulfillment of this promise. Peter says in 1 Peter 1, chapter 12, verse 12, that even, speaking about our salvation, that even the angels longed to catch a glimpse of how God would save people. So Peter says, looking at our salvation story, he said, the angels have been longing to get a glimpse of how God would do this. I imagine they were just as shocked as Isaiah. When Isaiah was told by God that a virgin will conceive and give birth, and they'll call him Emmanuel, God with us. It must have blown their mind. This is really the plan? So the angels aren't all-knowing. They're not omniscient. They don't know the whole story beforehand. So, just like us, the redemption narrative is unfolding to them, piece by piece. Just like it is for us, except that they're living on a different plane. They have a different sphere of existence. We meet Jesus from here below, but they have seen him from there above. And now, finally, one angel gets tapped on the shoulder to go and announce the birth of Jesus that they've been longing for, and the one they have been singing about for all of these years. They get to finally pick a group of people and come to them and tell them that the Savior has been born. That's why this message is worth listening to, paying close attention. Who is this Jesus that is coming to us? What is this announcement all about? And Charles Wesley, at the beginning of this hymn, begins to write about the titles of Jesus that the angels would have been all too familiar with. So he writes in the next verse, let's say together, Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Christ the everlasting Lord. And that's a perspective only the angels could have had. He is what Isaiah would call our everlasting Father. He has been the object of heaven's worship. So I kind of imagine this moment when one angel comes to deliver this news and immediately every host of angel comes in response. It wasn't like there was a countdown in heaven or some cue. Okay, now you go. They're just doing here what they were doing up there. Singing, worshiping, exalting Jesus. Just at the mention of their name, at the name of Jesus, they know they can't help but worship. So as one angel reveals to the shepherds who Jesus is, their immediate and only appropriate response is, we got to go worship him. So they show up on planet Earth singing about this newborn king, not because they had to or they were waiting for a cue. The mention of Jesus deserves worship. The announcement of his arrival deserves singing and honoring and awe. The thought of Jesus, the message of Christ revealed, our only response is to worship. And the angel says, well, if you're going to go announce Jesus, we're coming to sing behind you. Because that's how glorious and mighty and powerful he is. Late in time, behold him come. It's the words of Paul in Galatians 4, verse 4, when he said, in the fullness of time, just at the completion of time, right according to God's plan, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, so that we who were under the law could be redeemed as sons and daughters of God. So he came to us. Next verse reads like this. Let's say it together. Hail the flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. The word that John says in chapter 1 that was with God at the beginning now took on flesh and literally tabernacled. He lived as one of us, among us. And Paul would say in Colossians 2 verse 9 that the entire fullness, and this is something I still have a hard time getting my mind around, the entire fullness of the Godhead now is found in Jesus in bodily form. All of the glory, all of the nature, all of the awe-inspiring nature of the Godhead, all encapsulated in bodily form in the Christ who was born. This phrase stuck out to me this week. Pleased as man with man to dwell. Pleased. Jesus didn't lose a betting game or was coerced or forced to come. It pleased him to come. God so loved the world, he sent his son. The writer of Hebrews would say in Hebrews 4 that Jesus is our high priest who empathizes with us in our weakness. Why? Because he was one of us. It pleased him to come this way and to pursue us in this way. The next line reads like this. Let's say it together. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in its wings, in his wings. The last book of the Old Testament is the book of Malachi. in Malachi at the closing of this book writes about the Son of Righteousness, S-U-N, Son of Righteousness. Now, mind you, the end of Malachi then begins what is called the 400 years of silence. There is no new word from God, no prophet, no sighting of an angel. It's 400 years of absolute silence, and people are wondering and wandering and curious, is God going to keep his promise? But the last word they had was from the prophet Malachi, who said that the Son of God appearing, S-O-N, Son of God appearing, would be like the sun, S-U-N, the Son of Righteousness rising with healing in its wings. Malachi say, it's going to get dark, it's going to get lonely, it's going to get silent, but just when you least expect him, the Son of God will rise like the sun in the morning. Out of the dark night, out of the mystery, out of the chaos, he is rising as the sun. And when he comes, he brings healing on his wings. Malachi would describe the healing he brings as the heart of the father and the son are reconciled. The mother and the daughter, parent, child, every estranged relationship is reconciled because he brings healing in its wings. John 1, verse 4, John would say, in Jesus was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. He was the appearing of the sun for those of us who lived in the dark. And when he came, we could finally find light and come out of the dark and join him in this incredible light. Last verse reads like this. Let's say it together. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Mild, he lays his glory by. It's literally the imagery of Jesus taking off this garment of glory and laying it aside. If you remember in John 13, Jesus is there in the upper room. John says he removed his outer clothing and laid it aside and went to wash the feet of the disciples. He was literally in the garment of a servant, in the uniform of a servant or a slave with just his inner clothes. It was a visual for the coming of Jesus and the cross. I believe it's that moment that Paul writes about in Philippians 2, where he says, Jesus, though he was God and equal with God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. What does that mean? Not that he stopped being God, but he laid aside his glory. He laid aside the benefits of being God, the privileges, the prerogatives of being God. He laid it aside temporarily, still being God. He laid aside the benefits of glory, and he became part of humanity. And he humbled himself, how? By being born, but not just being born, by being born a servant, not just a servant, by being born a servant who would die, not just one who would die, but being born a servant who would die on a cross, a criminal's death. The lowest he could go, he went. This is the incredible humility of God who would lay aside his glory. This baby that was born in Bethlehem would die as an adult in Golgotha. This child that was laid in a cradle would hang on a cross. And he would taste death, as the writer of Hebrews says. Taste death. Why? So that you don't have to. So that he could overcome it. Not that we won't die, but that death won't be the end of our story. Death will just be the beginning of a face-to-face relationship with God for all eternity. Because why? Jesus there hung on the cross, and then he beat death, and he overcame the grave. Amen? This Christmas, we celebrate that a Savior is born and the Lord is risen. He was born, he died, and then he beat the grave and rose from the dead. We ought to give God a huge praise this morning for that. A Savior is born and the Lord is risen. And that means if you place your faith in Jesus, if you have or if you do, you experience a second birth. A birth that's better than your natural birth, but a spiritual birth that never dies. And though this life is removed, our life with God, our spiritual birth never dies, and we will be with God for all eternity long. He was born to die so that men and women, that we would never experience the sting and the power of death. He overcame it. This is the God we're celebrating. Apollo 8 was the historic mission in 1968 where human beings, for the first time, left the Earth's orbit, went to the moon, and orbited around the moon for the first time in human history. This iconic moment of humans leaving the orbit of the Earth. Three astronauts, James Lovell, Frank Borman, and William Anders, were part of the three astronauts who first human beings to ever leave Earth. And they took off from the Kennedy Space Center on December 21st, 1968. And their objective was to go to the moon, orbit around it, and land back safely. And they did on December 27th, 1968, which meant that for the first time, not only were humans out of the Earth in outer space, but that these three men would spend Christmas in outer space. So before they left, they decided to do a live broadcast back to planet Earth on Christmas Eve. And they began to think, what are we going to say? Because this, at that time in history, would be the greatest broadcast ever in history. Live broadcast from outer space. More human beings would listen to the voice of one person at one time than ever in history at that time. It's a big deal. All over the world, people will be tuning in to hear this broadcast on Christmas Eve. What are we going to say? Do we sing Jingle Bells? Do we, you know, sing a carol? So they go off outer space, and they gave the most fitting and appropriate words. As they are there on Christmas Eve, orbiting the moon and seeing from the distance our planet and the expanse of the universe, hear the message that these astronauts gave Christmas Eve, 1968, in the images that were captured on this Apollo 8 mission.
We are now approaching lunar sunrise, and for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day.
God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
Wow, isn't that amazing? Amen. I got chills the first time I heard that. For millions, even billions on planet Earth, this broadcast on Christmas Eve would be the defining moment of their life. As on Christmas Eve, they're hearing from the first astronauts ever to leave Earth and see the glory, the expanse, the breadth, the width of the universe that God spoke and created. the glory, the power of Almighty God. They're hearing the words of how God created and formed the universe on Christmas Eve. And then on Christmas morning, they would wake up to celebrate that this Creator God became an infant. He stepped into creation. This everlasting Lord entered into time. The Godhead, who is full of majesty and power and could create all things just with a spoken word, would now take residence in the womb of a teenage girl for 9 months and be born as a child. The Son of God, the one who is enveloped in glory, would lay it aside for humanity. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Prince of Peace, would enter our story. How fitting and how appropriate. This is a wonder of who we are celebrating this season. This Jesus, this God came to us and he came for us. It's the wonder of who the message of the angels is about. But I want to remind you quickly the wonder of who it's for. This announcement was not given to the religiously elite or the successful or the powerful. This announcement came to the shepherds. The shepherds. Today, we sort of sentimentalize the shepherds. They're kind and trustworthy. All the children, go and be shepherds. The shepherds were seen as thieves and robbers in the first century. When a shepherd came into town, the people of that town went the opposite way because they felt uneasy being around a shepherd. A shepherd's testimony was not even held in court because it was seemed to be unworthy or unreliable. They couldn't help but lie. They were estranged from any normal relationships because they didn't just work in the fields, they lived out in the fields, and they didn't smell all that great. So they lived there for the rest of their life. They were even considered ceremonially unclean. No access to God, no access to the temple. And it's fascinating that this announcement by the angels takes place about a month on the Jewish calendar, a month before Passover. So these shepherds are taking care of a large herd of sheep that are going to be used during the week of Passover. And these sheep are going to be offered as sacrifices to God. But the irony is these shepherds don't get to participate. They weren't going to be a part of the blessing of these sacrifices. They're always on the outside looking in, hoping, wondering if there was ever a plan of God that included them. And it's to them the angels come first. Because God is making it abundantly clear that God comes to those who feel the least deserving. He comes to the outcast. He comes to the sinful. He comes to whoever you think you might be, because there might be some of you feeling like the shepherd this morning. Jesus is for everybody else, but not for me. Christianity, God is for my neighbor, for the person that knows all the right lyrics and the verses, but not for me. But God is sending a clear message that whether you are religious or not, churched or not, whether you feel horrible about what you've done or who you've been with, no matter what you feel, where you've been, or you feel great about what you've done, we are equally undeserving of Jesus. Equally. Regardless of our attractions or actions, whatever we've done, apart from Jesus, we are all hopeless. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of his glory. Not one is righteous. We're all the shepherds in the story. And God says, it's for you that I came. If you feel disqualified or discounted, he had you particularly in mind. And I love the way that Wesley wrote this. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconcile. God and sinners reconcile. We broke the relationship, but God brought the reconciliation. We broke peace, but God establishes it. We broke the trust, but he comes to restore it. And he comes into our story as God, as the only one who could fix the relationship of our brokenness and the darkness we feel inside. And he offers us a gift of a Savior. He says, if you would trust in me, you can't achieve this peace. You can't work for it. You can't perform for it. You can't escape your role trying and hoping you'll have it someday. No, no, no. The only way to receive this peace is to receive freely the finished work of Jesus. When you turn from your sin and you turn to him as your Savior, You turn from doing life your own way and being your own boss, and you say, Jesus, I trust in you to be my Savior and my Lord. I'm coming out of the dark. I'm joining you in the light. You have peace with God. And that leads to peace with others and peace in yourself. Paul said it so beautifully in Romans 5:2, and I love Romans 5:1 and verse 2, and I love how the New Living Translation puts it. He says, therefore, we have been made right in God's sight by faith, not by works, not by our lineage, nor by faith. We have peace with God because of what Jesus, our Lord, has done for us. That's the only reason we have peace. It's all because of what he did for us. And because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege. We were the least deserving, all of us, but Jesus has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege, his grace, where we now stand and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing in God's glory. We don't stand fearfully or timidly, we stand joyfully because for us and to us, a Savior was born. I think about the shepherds being the first to hear this announcement from the angels, and I kind of wonder if partly they received this message because they were the only group of people who would have actually listened. Like, they're out in the night watching sheep. What else are they going to do? Not a lot going on. They're not all that busy or preoccupied or distracted. They've got the time. And so God goes to those who were willing and available to listen. If he had gone to the religious leaders, they would have dismissed the announcement by the angels because it did not fit their theological box. If he had gone to the scholars and the philosophers of his day, they would have rejected this news because it didn't fit their human wisdom. If he had gone to the successful, the powerful, the elite, they would have denied this invitation because it didn't fit their agenda. Just about every other group of people would have been unwilling to listen to the message of the angel because they were too preoccupied building their kingdoms and accomplishing their empires and pursuing their dreams. But God found the small group of shepherds, the outcasts of the day, those who had no credit to their name, but simply because they were available. They were willing to do what no one else did, which was leave everything behind in search of an angel. I'm sorry, in search of Jesus, simply because an angel told them. So they left everything, pursuing this newborn king. Are you willing today to listen to him? Are you available to hear his voice? Because this Christmas, God is speaking to you. This season, he is speaking directly to your heart. And here's the deal, most likely an angel isn't going to show up in the middle of the night and in your bedroom. Why? Because God doesn't need an angel anymore. He's given you Jesus, and he's given you the Holy Spirit, who always speaks and reveals Jesus to us. He sent his Son, and he sent his Spirit for you, and right now he is speaking to you. But are you busy, preoccupied? Building your own kingdoms, too busy to listen? Or could we pause and hear his voice? Stand with me, would you? I just wondered if you would pause and be willing to listen and respond. I want you to listen to the words of God that he is speaking to awaken a fresh wonder in your heart of who this message is about. Our majestic King born in a manger. And to awaken afresh the wonder that he came specifically for you and for me. Listen to him, even now. Close your eyes with me. Don't do it if you're driving. The rest of us, close your eyes. Hear his voice. Some of you are gonna have tears coming down your face. Some of you are gonna remember the first moment where you heard his voice and you surrendered your life to Jesus. For some of you, that's this moment. For God is saying, you're not disqualified. I came for you to save you, to redeem you, to buy you back. You're mine. Will you be willing to listen? Hark to the message of the angel that night, that for you in the city of David, a Savior has been born. Listen and respond.